Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the 38th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022, and the last meeting of 2022 as well. I've not received any apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed. Thank you, colleagues. And the next item on our agenda is the final oral evidence session as part of the committee's stage one scrutiny of the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And we are taking evidence from the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care and supporting officials. So a welcome to the committee, Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care. Good morning, Minister. Fiona Bennett, the Interim Deputy Director for NHS Integration and Social Care Finance. And Anne Kynaston, the Deputy Director of National Care Service Programme Design, Engagement and Legislation at Scottish Government. Good morning to you all. I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Thank you for having me along today to give evidence to this committee. You'll be aware that I've given evidence on the bill to several committees already, so it's good to come to the lead committee, although I do have another two to come. It's fair to say, Convener, that the National Care Service is one of the most ambitious reforms of public services. It will end the postcode lottery of care provision in Scotland and ensure that those who need it have access to consistent and high-quality care and support to enable them to live a full life wherever they are. The NCS bill sets out a framework for the changes that we want to make and allows scope for further decisions to be made. This flexibility enables the National Care Service to develop, adapt and respond to specific circumstances over time. I want to take time this morning to reflect on why change of this scale is necessary. Scotland's community health and social care system has seen significant incremental change over the last 20 years. Despite this, people with experience of receiving care, support and providing it have been clear that there remains some significant issues. We're not just changing to address the challenges of today. We must ensure that we build a public service fit for tomorrow. Today, about 1 in 25 people receive social care, social work and occupational health support in Scotland. Demand is forecast to grow. The NCS must be developed to take account of our future needs, and we'll build a system that is sustainable and future-proofed to take account of the changing needs of our population. The principles of any new system will be person-centred, with human rights at the very heart of social care. This means that the NCS will be delivered in a way that respects, protects and fulfils the human rights of people accessing care support and their carers. Improved carer support is one of the core objectives of establishing the NCS. As part of the human rights-based, outcome-focused approach, carers and people with care needs will be able to access support which is preventative and consistent across Scotland. Nationally and locally, the NCS will work with specialist charity and third sector providers of social care, as well as other third sector organisations in the field of social care, to meet the needs of people. The NCS will bring changes that will benefit the workforce too. The importance of staff in the social care sector has never been clearer, and we are fully committed to improving their experience as we recognise and value the work that they do. The NCS will ensure enhanced pay and conditions for workers and act as an exemplar in its approach to fair work. Our co-design process will ensure that NCS is built with the people that it serves and those that deliver it. They have to be at the very heart of all of this. I've noticed that your committee has been out and about, hearing from those with lived experience of social care across Scotland. And you've also heard from organisations who represent them. I was delighted to see that, as it's vitally important that we listen to these people as we establish the National Care Service. We are committed to working with people with first-hand experience of accessing and delivering community health and social care to ensure that we have a person-centred National Care Service that best fits the needs of the people who will use and work in its services, with human rights at the very centre. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you, Minister, and thank you for referencing the amount of outreach work we've done, and just give me the opportunity to thank everyone who we've met across Scotland in our outreach work and public engagement. Minister, I'm going to put two very common queries that people have put to us to you. So they've come up quite a lot from both the informal sessions that we've had and also the formal sessions. So over our weeks of evidence gathering, so many of the people that we've spoken to have said to us that relating to care, there's already a lot of excellent legislation, there's already excellent policies that they were very excited about when they were announced. There's lots of frameworks, there's lots of strategies, but there's a big implementation gap. So the question is, that's been put to us, how would the National Care Service close that implementation gap? Do we need a National Care Service to close that implementation gap? And why can't that be done now? So that's the first question. And the second question that's been put to us, or a certain comment that's been put to us, is there is not enough detail in this bill for people to actually ascertain what the National Care Service is going to be. So I'll put those two questions to you in the winner. They're big questions, but they're ones that come out a lot.
Convener, they are big questions, and they're questions that have all also been asked of me over the piece, particularly around about the implementation gap. I said in my initial statement there that we have been on a 20-year journey of integration, and things have improved out there, but quite rightly, you have heard from people around about gaps, about implementation gaps, as I have too. You have heard quite obviously about legislation, which, let's be honest, in many cases has been very good legislation, but the spirit of that legislation has not been put into practice, and that loopholes have been found to try not to implement in the way that was envisaged. So why is it that the National Care Service is needed, and why will it make that difference? Well, first of all, we will see the national high quality standards come into play to end the postcode lotteries. So let's look at an example of good legislation and yet implementation gaps. And some of the folk round this table, Ms. Harper in particular, have seen this at first hand along with me. And that's around about self-directed support legislation. So self-directed support legislation, Parliament came together and came up with what I think was excellent legislation. However, that has not been implemented in the way it should have in many parts of Scotland. So over the course of the summer, I spent quite a lot of time speaking to folk around about SDS, including in Dumfries with Ms. Harper. And there are stark differences in terms of being able to access all four options of self-directed support. There are stark differences in terms of the amount of money that is given to folk for their self-directed support. And there are vast differences in terms of the flexibilities that are or are not allowed. Now, that is really frustrating for people, particularly for folks, you know, who know others in other parts of the country who are getting more of a service than they are. So these are the kind of things that we need to change. Now, that not all of that has to wait for National Care Service and the National High Quality Standards. Many of you will know that we updated, at my insistence, the self-directed support guidance just recently in order that we do this better. But to truly end the postcode lotteries of care provision that exist across Scotland, we need to go one step further, and that is the National High Quality Standards. So the National Care Service will oversee the delivery of care, improve those standards, seek enhanced pay and conditions for workers, as I said earlier, and provide better support for unpaid carers. And one of the key elements of all of this is that the National Care Service will support ethical commissioning of care, acting and building up as an exemplar when it comes to our approach to fair work. In terms of your question around about detail, I too have had folk saying to me that they want more detail, and some people think I'm dodging questions at point when they ask me about detail about a particular thing. But we have said, convener, that we will co-design how we move forward with the voices of lived experience. And it is those voices of those who currently receive care and support, their carers and frontline staff, that will help us fill those implementation gaps. So this will be bottom-up shaping of a service that will work for all.
Thank you. I'm going to pass on to my colleagues a question from Emma Harper. Emma.
Just to pick up on the self-directed support stuff, and you did come to Dumfries and we spent some time together, and I really appreciate that because it allowed me to see that some people were really happy with what had been offered as far as self-directed support, and then other folk hadn't even been offered it and never heard of it. So would the national approach or a national training approach involve making sure that self-directed support and the ability to offer it would be delivered in a way where people know it exists, know what it means, know what options there are, so that that could then be delivered by 32 local authorities in a more standardised way?
Yes, indeed. It has to be delivered in a way that suits everyone. Now, one of the things which I've heard time and time again is folks saying that they have never been offered self-directed support, they have been denied self-directed support in certain parts of the country, or the offer that has been given to them has been very limited indeed. That's not the way that this was supposed to work. This was supposed to give folks the opportunity and the rights to ensure that they could decide upon their own care and give them the flexibility and the independence to be able to do that. Now, I'm not saying that everything out there is bad, because it's not, and we know that there is some very good practice where some authorities are going above and beyond the call of duty to build in flexibilities to get it right for individuals and for families. Now, what I want to see is that thinking going on everywhere across Scotland. That's why the National High Quality Standards are so important in all of this. And beyond that, we also need to look at where it doesn't go right, what is the complaints situation, and what is the redress for the individual and for their family where we're not getting this right. And that's why we have also committed to establish a complaints and redress service for the National Care Service that provides a fair, effective and consistent approach to complaints and redress. And we'll identify opportunities to improve how complaints are handled. Because it's not just the fact that folk are not getting access, it's the fact that when they complain about it, they feel that they're not listened to, and we need to change that.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Going back to I suppose what we said at the beginning about, we've had some interesting sessions with people that are assuming that the National Care Service is going to do certain things like take away the assets of local authorities. Electronic cards were mentioned way back at the beginning of the evidence session. So one of the things that might help us is tell us what the National Care Service is and what it isn't, because there have been issues that have been brought up about transfer of staff and also assets that currently belong to the local authority, for instance, and the electronic cards is something that for me was interesting because I questioned about that. So tell us how to dispel some of the myths that have already been created about the National Care Service.
Convener, can I say at the very start that I have got absolutely no want or desire to take folks' electric cars off them, to be honest with you. And there has been some myths around about assets and around about staff transfer. The NCS bill only gives Scottish ministers powers to transfer staff from local authorities to care boards or to the government as part of the NCS. However, there is no desire for wholesale transfers of staff. We have got many local authorities who are delivering very good social care services, and we see local authorities as being essential delivery partners as we move forward. However, within the bill itself, we have to have a situation whereby, because care boards will become the provider of last resort, that there is the ability to transfer staff if a care board becomes that provider of last resort. So what I'm saying is it's by no means a foregone conclusion that local authority staff will have to transfer their employment. And it remains the Scottish Government's position that the new local care boards will work collaboratively even with local, and of course in partnership with local authorities, NHS boards, third and independent sectors, locally and nationally. And it is our intention that local staffing decisions will be taken by local care boards as they are established. So that is where we are at in all of this. I've heard rumour of 74,000 staff being transferred. That's not on our agenda.
Short question, and I'll go to Tess.
Very short question, and then I'm happy to move on, but I'm sure I'll pick up on stuff later. People have given us evidence and said, why don't you fix it now? The National Care Service, we should really not pursue it at this point because we really need to act now and fix it now. And so why would we waste so much money, $1.5 billion, on the National Care Service or this massive structural reform instead of just fixing it now? What would you respond to that?
Whatever we invest in the National Care Service is for the good of people. But we know that there is work to do in the here and now, and this is not all about the formulation of the National Care Service, and that is why we're also acting in the here and now, which will be for the good of the establishment of NCS2. So, Convener, I'm very pleased that COSLA have agreed that additional actions that we will jointly take across the next 12 to 18 months to bring about improvements of the delivery of social care support now. That's through our joint statement of intent. But I have to say that we have heard repeatedly from people with lived experience that the current adult social care system must change to drive up standards to a consistent level right across our country. We need to tackle that postcode lottery of care, and a different approach is needed. We must have a system where high-quality community health and social care support helps to create thriving communities across Scotland. And that's why we have brought forward this bill, a framework bill, to support the collaborative design with people to ensure that we address that historic implementation gap that has already been mentioned. And that implementation gap between policy and legislative intent and service delivery must be closed. That is top of the agenda for people. So NCS is important, but absolutely the work here and now is important too. And that's why we will work with COSLA to ensure those additional actions in our newly published statement of intent.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener. Tess White.
Thank you. So, Minister, I ask this question. I've got three hats. One, as a member of this committee, also as a representative for a largely rural area, and I'm a fellow of the Chartered Institute Personnel and Development with experience in TUPE legislation. So have you considered the cost of harmonising the terms and conditions? And I accept that you say that not all the 74,000 employees will transition under TUPE, but a large chunk could. So have you considered that? For example, even increasing mileage rates of 45 pence a mile to 65 pence a mile, and that was a figure that was given to us by some of the witnesses, will cost millions of pounds. And not to mention harmonising sickness and pension benefits, which will go into the billions. So are you really serious about wanting to transition to a central service for what you say in your opening? Or is this plain and simply a power grab to centralise services and with the view of taking budgets away from the local councils?
No, this is not a power grab, but it is responding to what we have heard from people right across the country. They want to see ministerial responsibility for social care. And it comes as a shock, and has come as a shock to many of them, that, you know, while I can, as a minister, help legislate, bring about policy, that I've got no direct influence over service delivery. It comes as a shock, I think, to many members in this place who write to me all of the time asking me to intervene in situations which I can't do because I'm not responsible for the delivery of community health and social care. So we are responding to people who believe that ministers should have accountability for the delivery of social care. We're also responding to people in the fact that they think that that accountability at a local level should be enhanced, which I agree with too. So this is not a power grab, it is a response to people. In terms of the work that we have done, around about transfer, staff transfers and pensions. As I said, the NCS bill only gives ministers powers to transfer staff from local authorities to care boards. But as I said earlier in my response to Ms Harper, it's by no means a foregone conclusion that there will be wholesale transfer of staff. The government, of course, is, as always, very well aware of repercussions of transfers. And that is why we have done and are continuing to work on all of this to ensure that we get it right. If we do see transfers, We will, of course, engage and consult with trade unions on transfer of staff. And if it is agreed that any staff will transfer to the National Care Service following discussions with local authorities, cheapy regulations would apply as set out in section 31(4) of the bill. And the government would engage with the recognised trade unions in line with TUPE and COSOP, that's Cabinet Office Statement of Practice regulations. TUPE and COSOP require place requirements on both sides to consult with trade unions in good time, and we would ensure that such consultation takes place. And our intention would, of course, to be ensuring that we avoid any detriment to staff, including in relations in line with pensions. But I reiterate the point that I made to Ms Harper, that there is no intention to see a wholesale transfer of staff.
Tess.
Thank you, Convener. I can just press you on this point, Minister. We've heard that part of the issue with the current staffing issues is that social carers cannot be recruited. One of the issues is the mileage rates, 45p, and they're looking to have their mileage rates the equivalent to 65p. That might seem small to you, but to many of these carers, the difference between 45p and 65p in a mileage rate can make the difference between surviving in a job and not surviving in a job. Now, the harmonising just the mileage rates will be millions of pounds. And you might say, well, we're not going to do it and we're not going to think about it and TUPE legislation and all that sort of thing. But I'm just thinking in terms of fairness. If you're working, doing the same job as somebody else, and they're on 65p a mile and you're on 45p a mile, that could lead to employee relations, industrial unrest. Do you have a comment about that?
I have a lot of comments about that, Convener, because I know that some folk out there are not even getting 45p a mile for their mileage rates. And I declare an interest, Convener, because I have two nieces who work in social care, one of whom who works in rural Aberdeenshire. So I know how hard those mileage costs have hit. And that is why I've written to the UK government not once, but on a number of occasions, around about them changing the rates that they set in order that we can do better for folk out there. And also urging the UK government to find additional resource to deal with those increased fuel costs, which, you know, they're taking much more money in terms of fuel duty and VAT because of those. Let's use some of that money to pay social care and other vital workers across the UK better mileage rates. Unfortunately, I've yet to hear from the UK government on this issue. And I wish that they would take cognizance of what I've laid out for the good of social care and other vital workers, not only here in Scotland, but right across these islands. In terms of the future, Convener, at the heart of this bill is ethical procurement and fair pay and conditions. And do we aspire to do better in all of this? Absolutely we do. We need to do this for the simple reason that if we don't, we are going to be unable to grow the social care profession, which has taken a huge hit in recent times. We have lost lots of people because of Brexit, and we need to replenish that staffing core. And in order to attract young people to the social care profession, we are going to have to do much better in terms of pay and conditions, but also in terms of providing career pathways so that they see the profession as being the right one for them. That is the only way that we will make that workforce sustainable for the future.
Questions from Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and to his team. I wonder if I can just return to the point about potential transfer of staff and that 74,000 number, which I think you described as a rumour, Minister, or rumours to that effect in your contribution. I think trade unions, local authorities and frontline staff would contend that it's actually a legitimately held concern that 74,000 staff might be transferred. But I appreciate what you've said there in terms of your view that wholesale transfer is not envisaged and that it could be, for example, the example you gave, I think, was the provider of last resort. Now, my understanding currently is that a council would be a provider of last resort anyway and, currently fulfils that function. But I wonder if we're in the business of trying to clear up rumours and dispel rumours, are there any other reasons you would see that staff might transfer to a care board?
There may be other reasons that staff may transfer to a care board. It may well be that a care board, for example, puts in some specialist provision in terms of the flexibilities that they're allowed within their area, and they may want to transfer staff to fill those positions. Of course, that would have to come with agreement of all in that regard. But I come back to the point, why would we transfer huge swathes of staff if the employer is currently a good one and is delivering good, high-quality social care? I've made no bones about this during the course of this discussion. There are folk out there who continue to say that I want to grab and transfer 74,000 people to the National Care Service because it's a bit of empire building. That's not the case. And I hope that local authorities across the country will continue to be prime delivery partners, good delivery partners, serving people in their communities. That is the ambition.
So if we take that as read, what you've just said, and take you on your word there, why in the bill have you not spelled out that that's what you're intending to do, that it's a provider of last resort? Or indeed, as I think you referred to, specialist provision, which I don't know if you can expand on that, but I presume maybe specialist learning disability services, something like that. I wonder if you can say why you haven't spelled out what you've just said on the face of the bill to give confidence to people who are clearly very anxious. I mean, we heard in evidence from trade unions, from local authorities and from frontline staff that there is anxiety, not least about the implications potentially of CHUPI and the implications for things like pensions. And I appreciate you've written to the committee in that regard, but it's about dispelling the anxiety for people. So I don't know if you want to take the opportunity just to clear some of that up.
Can I suggest, convener, and I've said this at other committees as well, alongside the draft bill, there are a suite of documents which includes the policy memorandum. And paragraph 48 of the policy memorandum spells all of this out. And I would direct the committee to look at that in depth. I would ask others to look not just at the draft bill itself, but also to look at the policy memorandum and the other suite of documents that we have published. Beyond that, convener, in terms of all of these issues, you know, I continue and will always listen to what folks have got to say. I want to allay fears and concerns. I want to ensure that people are enthused by what we are trying to achieve here. And the key thing for me, and I declare an interest as a trade unionist myself, as a member of Unison, is that I want to ensure that we have a workforce which is bolstered by Fair Work and which, you know, has that ethical procurement guarding its back in terms of Fair Work and paying conditions.
Convener, I wonder if I might turn to some of the financial implications and indeed the financial memorandum. Last week we heard from Cathy Russell, who in terms of Care Home Relative Scotland and the Social Covenant Steering Group, who said, I'm quoting, "What worries me to some extent is that we hear figures such as the £500 million cost of the new structure, or that Scotland thinks it could be more than £1 billion, but we will not get an extra hour of care for that. None of that will be spent on the front line." So I wonder if the Minister can explain why existing government commitments on the reform of social care, as listed in the financial memorandum, were not included on the face of the bill. And can you give any progress in terms of progress towards fulfilling such commitments?
Convener, no financial commitments are being directly made from the financial memorandum. The process of co-design will continue and detailed work done on the preferred options will be done through a business case process before spend is committed to. And again, there is a number of things which have been said around about the financial memorandum which are not quite correct. So, for example, in the financial memorandum, it's clear that over 40% of the projected costs relate to improved pay and terms and conditions for frontline social care workers, not bureaucracy costs. The estimated costs in the financial memorandum largely represent investments in service improvements and terms and conditions for frontline staff. And any suggestion that the figures relate exclusively to administration or bureaucracy costs are totally false. Additionally, in investment in areas such as support services will directly improve areas such as data analysis, planning and reporting, allowing us to better understand outcomes and tailor future investment to have the biggest impact on our citizens. We as a government have said that we will increase social care spend by 25%, some £840 million by the end of this parliament. That is in our manifesto, and we shall do so. But again, convener, I recognise that there have been some criticisms of the financial memorandum, which was done before the current financial, economic and economic crisis. We will consider what has been put to us and come back with an enhanced financial memorandum. But not all social care spend, which is going on at this moment and will continue to do so, is covered by a financial memorandum which covers bill aspects only.
Yeah, no, I appreciate what the Minister's just said there, and I think everyone would welcome an enhanced financial memorandum. I think that's very important, not least because of the significant concerns that were raised by colleagues in the Finance Committee. I just wonder if that enhanced financial memorandum will include consideration of the VAT liabilities that are involved in this process.
The financial memorandum will cover all aspects that pertain to the bill. And as the committee knows, we are working at this moment to ensure that we cover all bases when it comes to any liabilities, including VAT. The best option here would be for the Treasury to rule that there would be no VAT liabilities, and we will continue to push and prod the Treasury in that front.
Thanks, Convener. And I'll maybe pop both of my questions into one to maybe try and save some time. Morning, Minister. We've heard from witnesses a difference in opinion of what the bill could achieve in the medium term. Could you provide some practical examples of what impact the bill could have on some of the current issues that are facing social care? And obviously this is a large piece of structural reform, and a lot of the issues we're covering today, quite rightly, are very technical, but for many in the general public that'll be difficult to digest and follow, but will potentially have a large impact on how they or a loved one receives care. So what differences do you hope that workers and those receiving care will see as a result of this legislation?
We've had a fair amount of discussion already this morning around about implementation gaps and the postcode lottery, and also the fact that folk often feel that their complaints and concerns are not addressed properly. So I think three things from that. We want to ensure that those implementation gaps are plugged and that we end those postcode lotteries. It is galling for some folks to see people who often live not that far away from them getting better services for a condition than they are. And that's why the National High Quality Standards is important in ensuring that we end those postcode lotteries. But also, you know, we need to garner the knowledge of people themselves in order to help us fill those implementation gaps. And in all of that, too, preventative approaches have to be at the heart of all that we do. We talk a lot about person-centred care, and lots of folk get person-centred care, but we need that to apply to everyone. And that's why getting it right for everyone is at the heart of all of this too. Crisis costs a lot of money, and it would be so much better in terms of the public purse, but also for the human cost when we get it wrong, to move to more prevention rather than deal with crisis. In terms of delivering this, ethical procurement and fair work are so important. We need to ensure that we move forward in this front to improve recruitment and retention, which we know is a problem. But more than that, as I said earlier in an earlier answer, we need to attract new folk to this profession. We need to attract young people into what is vital work. And in order to do so, we have to show folks that they are valued, not only just in terms of the pay and conditions, but also in terms of career progression. Now, we have a situation at the moment, convener, where we have 1,200 employers. You know, it is often difficult to deal with that situation. But with every single contract having ethical procurement and fair work at its heart, we can do much, much better.
I want to pick up on things that the Minister has said in this theme, and I'm going to take them individually just to ask your one question on this, because we'll need to move on to talk about co-design and implementation in detail. So first on my list is Sandesh. Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Minister. You said in response that you have a joint statement of intent with COSLA to make improvements now. How many meetings have you had and your officials had with COSLA once the statement's been made? And can you name one change that you're going to make?
Well, we published a new statement of intent yesterday. And I have to say that there are constant meetings between officials and COSLA officials. And as you can imagine, I see the COSLA Health and Social Care spokesperson, Paul Kelly, on a very regular basis, because he is involved in many of the groups, including the Ministerial Advisory Group, which he co-chairs with the Cabinet Secretary, in terms of dealing with the here and now. And if we look at, and I'll give you one example, of where I want to see improvement and improvement quickly. And I'm quite sure that COSLA officials would agree, is that I believe that it is scandalous that many women working in social care at this moment have no maternity pay entitlements. Absolutely scandalous in the 21st century. That is one of the first things on my list for improvement. And I think that the statement of intent will help us move forward on that front and get rid of some of the antiquated employment situations that exist.
A question from Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Morning. We heard from Derek Feely in evidence that he felt the National Care Service needed to be progressed at pace. However, we've also heard in evidence from many that they want a pause. What would you say to that?
We can't afford to pause. We need to change the system. We have to do that carefully, and we have to do that incrementally, and we have to do that ensuring that as we move forward, we're getting everything right. And this is the dilemma for me, because I know there are many folks like Derek Feely who want things moving at a pace, and there are many folk who actually want change yesterday. Let's be honest, there are activists out there who have been campaigning for social care change for decades, and they have seen some change, as we've spoken about earlier, but all of this does not go far enough for them. We have got a job to do here in terms of getting this right. That means that we have to take people with us and we have to have people at the very heart of the co-design of the service. That's going to take a bit of time. We also have a situation where Parliament, quite rightly, wants to scrutinise what we're doing. That's right too. That's going to take a bit of time. And, you know, we have to build the confidence of all as we move forward. And sometimes that takes a bit of time. So while I very much understand Derek Feely wanting to see change at pace, and I understand those activists that want to see change yesterday, I, the government, this committee, this parliament, have to recognise that there is work to be done, and sometimes that work takes a little bit of time. So there's a fine balance to be struck here, is what I'm saying, basically.
Thank you. And a question from Carol before we move into talking about co-design in more detail. Carol.
Thank you, Convener. I want to start by saying that I think pausing the bill does not mean pausing some of the urgent changes that are needing to social care. And we have plenty of evidence and quotes from professional organisations, trade unions, third sector, indicating that there's a lot that we can do now. The specific question I have for you now is around collective sectoral bargaining. And I want to know, have the government considered this? Have you had any advice on this? And will you commit to talking to the trade unions now about this? Because throughout the evidence sessions that we have heard, and you have mentioned it yourself, we can sort pay terms and conditions for social work staff, and that will make the biggest difference that we possibly can to getting quite rightly the care and support that individuals need in their day-to-day life. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. National sectoral bargaining at this moment is nigh near impossible because of the current setup. As I've said earlier, you know, dealing with 1,200 disparate employers is difficult. As the committee knows, in the past year, the government has increased pay twice for adult social care workers. But it has not been easy to get that money into the pockets and purses of those folks on the front line. Through the National Care Service, We want to see improvements in terms of terms and conditions, as I've stated many times this morning. And that includes improvements through national sectoral bargaining for the sector. However, our work on introducing sectoral bargaining is progressing ahead of the National Care Service in line with the recommendations of the Fair Work Convention. In August, government officials held a session to start the initial exploratory work on the sectoral bargaining with key members of the Fair Work and Social Care Group. That meeting, of course, was attended also by COSLA, by trade unions, and by provider representatives. And regular meetings with these key stakeholders are now taking place to move this work forward and to establish a set of recommendations. Convener, it would be fair to say that I've spoken with and listened to a number of trade union colleagues over the piece, and I will continue to do so. I've had a number of separate meetings with the GMB. The last big meeting I had with trade unions was in the company of the First Minister and Mr. Lockhead to talk about trade union issues across the piece. But obviously, National Care Service played a major part in those discussions. And we will continue to listen to trade unionists as we move forward. And we will continue to try and make improvements in the here and now through our Fair Work and Social Care Group.
I want to put on the record just to mention that Paula Kane mentioned the letter that we received from the Minister yesterday, and just to let everyone know that that is on our committee section of the Scottish Parliament website for anyone to look at it. But I know that members have actually read that, where we wrote to the Minister about terms and conditions, pensions, the workforce and the inclusion of Fair Work in the bill. So it's quite a comprehensive letter, and it's publicly available now. Right, we move on to talk about co-design, timing, implementation and evaluation. And Emma, you have some questions on that.
Thanks, Convener, again. We've heard people talk about co-design and co-production, but they're often used the same interchangeably, but we know that co-design is actually different. Tell us, Minister, what co-design is in terms of shaping the National Care Service Bill?
Well, I think that's a very good question, and sometimes there is some confusion. So co-design is working with people in an equal and reciprocal partnership in the design of services, policies, frameworks and interventions. And involvement starts from understanding the present to deciding what the future should look like and how we all get there. And there are three clear phases to the National Care Service collaborative design. The first one is understanding. That's building on that shared understanding of the current challenges that I mentioned. The second is sense-making. What and how can we deliver the improvement that we all want to see? And the third is agreement. Do the proposed changes address the issues raised by people? So the initial co-design themes were launched at the National Care Service Forum in October, and they will focus specifically on the information needed to develop policy directly associated with the passage of the bill. So those are information sharing to improve health and social care support. So that includes things like data sharing. Realising rights and recognising responsibilities. So that's the human rights work and the charter development. Keeping health and social care support local. So that will look at care boards, geography and board representation, for example. Making my voice heard, looking at things like advocacy and complaints, and valuing the workforce, which will look at issues such as ethical commissioning. So I hope that helps Ms Harper and the committee.
As part of the co-design process, how will the government ensure that national accountability allows for local implementation and flexibility? Because we know that there's a big difference in developing a care to be delivered in the city of Glasgow versus rural Dumfries and Galloway, for instance. So I am assuming co-design will be, it will be ongoing rather than have an end point in designing the whole services as we go forward.
Absolutely. While we need everyone to adhere to the national high quality standards in terms of delivery, we also have to have the ability and flexibility to create the right thing for places in terms of delivery. That will also allow for innovation. So to give an example, I have had discussions with folks from our island communities, and it may well be that we need to do things differently there. And, you know, we will listen and act and react accordingly. And I think Ms Harper is right, because delivery may be somewhat different in rural Galloway compared to Glasgow. And we have to allow for those flexibilities. So let's give an example and what I see as an opportunity. During the course of COVID, we see many communities, community organisations step up to the plate and provide help, care and support when others were unable to do so for some of our most vulnerable folk. Some of that work has continued in some places. But, you know, ethical procurement gives an opportunity for community wealth building. It may well be that some rural, also some urban communities, choose to try and deliver care in their own locales. Often, the current procurement practices have been a barrier to those kind of things. Ethical procurement can open up the door here. So it may well be that we'll see in rural Galloway or in Orkney or maybe even in Glasgow, others coming forward in terms of providing care and support, and we'll be able to do so through that ethical procurement methods.
Just a question on the monitoring and evaluation of the implementation of this framework bill and then the delivery. And how would you perceive that we monitor and evaluate the implementation and then this and success, assuming it will be a success, of the bill?
It's not just about the bill. And I think that the key thing here is that implementation and ensuring that those implementation gaps that we've talked about so often today are plugged. Now, I will say to the committee, and I've been honest about this previously, and I'm going to be honest again, you know, it is often very difficult for us to gather up data around about what is going on out there. And that is one of the reasons why data is so important as we move forward. Now, there's been a lot of to-ing and fro-ing around about certain aspects of social care delivery and costs, etc. But it is very difficult for me as minister to garner up some of that information. We need to change that. We also need to look at much more at outcomes and what is working for people and what is not. And while, you know, we have a fair amount of information on that, it's still not enough. So as we move forward, we have to become more adept at gathering data in order to be able to monitor properly. Beyond that, we also need to continue to listen to the voices of lived experience as we continue on this journey. And that's why, you know, I've not really talked about the makeup of local care boards very much, but one thing which I have said is that I'm absolutely adamant that the voices of lived experience should be at the table at local care boards and should have voting rights, because in terms of monitoring what is going on, ensuring that we plug those implementation gaps, they are the experts.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to pass on to Paul O'Kane, but before I do, because the Minister has mentioned outcomes, there's something that I was wanting to raise, and now seems a really good point to make it. We've heard, particularly from people that work in social care, that the time and task model does not focus on outcomes. And I want to ask the Minister directly how we are going to have systems in place that prioritise outcomes for people rather than systems dictating the amount of time that perhaps the home carer comes in and spends with them, when actually they might need more than the 15 minutes. You know the scenarios. They've been mentioned to us. People's outcomes rather than a system dictating what they get in terms of care.
That is an extremely important question. And it cuts to the crunch around about prevention rather than crisis that I was talking about earlier with Ms. Mackay. In some areas already, we are seeing freedom and autonomy given to frontline staff, who are the folk who recognise if Mrs. Smith is becoming frailer or Mrs. Smith is improving. So in my home city of Aberdeen, the Granite Care Consortium, their frontline staff have the ability to step up and to step down care. Obviously, that has to be done in consultation with the person who's receiving care and support in their families. And obviously, there's more stepping up of care than there is stepping down. But, you know, their ability to do that puts the person front and centre. But beyond that, if we look at delayed discharge, for example, the best way of stopping delayed discharge is stopping folk from going in the front door of a hospital in the first place. So by stepping up Mrs. Smith's care, are we actually saving a journey to A&E and maybe a lengthy stay in hospital? And I reckon in a lot of cases, we are. So that autonomy, that freedom, that independence for frontline staff, which largely does not exist in many places because of contracts, we need to change. Now, we are trying to change that in the here and now. I don't want to wait for NCS if we can get some flexibility around about that in the here and now. That would be brilliant, you know. That would be good, not only for health and social care partnerships, local authorities. It would be very, very good for people at this moment in time. And, you know, we will continue to try and persuade and give comfort to local authorities, to health and social care partnerships, around about trying to change contracts at this moment. This is clearly working in Aberdeen. There have been changes implemented in Fife 2, which I think are benefiting people. We need to see more of this. And I want to see more of this before NCS, but NCS gives us that complete opportunity with ethical procurement.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'm very grateful. Can I ask what the Minister's rationale was for a promise of co-design after the bill was passed rather than in the preparation of the bill? Is it your view that co-design after the fact is better than co-design before we get to legislation? And who decided that the bill should proceed in that manner?
We have to have a framework before we can move to co-design. We had to show the people who we want to help us co-design all of this with us, that there was a framework to blanket that co-design around. And why did we come to that decision? We came to that decision because that is the logical way. And we came to that decision because we looked at what has happened previously. And I would remind the committee that in terms of the formation of the National Health Service, it was a framework bill. And, you know, I think that the National Health Service has been a wee bit of a success, has it not?
OK, I'm not sure we're comparing apples and oranges there. I wonder, though, if I can move that on slightly and just quote to the Minister some of the evidence we've heard. He said that he feels it's a logical process that he's adopted, but we've heard that, and I'm going to quote here, at the moment it feels like it's a one-size-fits-all system, and I don't think that will work. So much is left to secondary legislation and co-design, we don't feel that we can have the detail to be able to comment. We're talking about a substantial bill on a national care service that has been introduced without clear detail. The bill does not deliver the changes that are required. And then finally, it's like buying a house without ever having seen it or knowing how many rooms it has or where it's located. So that's a cross-section of the evidence we've heard from legal experts, Commonweal, care providers, local authorities and trade unions. So I think those are very serious concerns about the way this has been done. And I wonder if the Minister would like to comment on some of those quotes.
I could also, you know, provide quotes from people with lived experience who want to be at the heart of shaping the National Care Service, which is, after all, delivering for them as we move forward. And I recognise, you know, that some people are worried around about change. I get that. And change is often of concern. But what I have said, and I will continue to say, is that we will be open and transparent as we move forward on this journey and continue to listen to people and allow the opportunity for scrutiny. So let me give you the example of secondary legislation. And I know that there are many people out there, there are many people in here, who always feel that everything has to be in the face of the bill. Everything has to be in primary legislation. But that doesn't allow for the flexibility that we often need in terms of change. And I give you the example of self-directed support and the legislation there that I mentioned earlier. Most of that, all of that almost, is in primary legislation. Now, we know that there are loopholes which folk are using to avoid the spirit of the Act. Now, you know, in order to close those loopholes, you have to go back to primary legislation. It would be so much easier that if we had things in secondary legislation, if we find loopholes, if we find an implementation gap, then we have the ability to change that pretty quickly in order to get that right for people. Now, I recognise that some folk don't like that. And if we were to make change, of course, we would consult and listen to people. But that, I think, is a major way of ensuring that we have the flexibility of getting all of this right as we move on in the future.
I wonder, Convener, if I can put another quote to the Minister. The significant gaps highlighted throughout a report in combination with the Scottish Government's approach to introducing the primary legislation prior to the completion of the co-design process has frustrated the parliamentary scrutiny process. That was from the Finance Committee's report on the bill. So given everything I said in my previous question and the concerns of other committees of this Parliament, does the Minister not recognise that there is an opportunity here to pause and to get back around the table and to listen to these concerns and try and address them before we move to legislation?
What I said at the Finance Committee was if we had done it the other way around, there would have been detractors that way too. And this approach allows for the scrutiny of the principles before the co-design starts. That provides reassurance for people in the co-design process and gives them reassurance that their contributions matter.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. Minister, I raised the issue of sustainability of co-design with Derek Feely. Given the number of work streams currently underway and the length of time co-design could take place over, what work is being done to ensure that those contributing, particularly those with lived experience, can continue to do so and can do so in a way that is not unduly taxing?
Good question. Convener, first of all, and I'm not going to dodge Ms. Mackay's question, but I want to start off with something that I should have maybe said in terms of my response to Ms. Harper earlier. You know, some folks, you know, have talked about what is co-design. So one of the key elements, first of all, is that we've got a job of work to do in terms of the introduction to co-design sessions, which many of which are now complete, which demystifies the process for people, and over 200 folk have taken part in those so far. So that gives them a fair grounding of the task that they are going to embark on. And Ms. Mackay is right. We want to ensure that we have all of the voices that we possibly can at the co-design table. And we have gone out of our way to try and attract folk with various conditions from various parts of the country. And of course, we also have to take cognizance of the fact that some folks may require help and support, and that may mean financial support, in order to take part in this process. We'll continue to listen to that and provide support that we can. We also have to ensure that we, along the way, continue that listening process and continue to encourage people to come forward. We also have to look at the activities around about co-design, which will vary. So there will be a number of things which are suitable to meet the needs of individuals. So that may mean one-to-one sessions. That may mean surveys. That may mean group sessions. And the recruitment for the lived experience panels, of which we now have over 400 folk in, that will continue throughout National Care Service development. And when I say over 400, I probably should say 450, because I think that's the latest number.
Through co-design and evidence gathering, you will likely, as we've heard, good examples of good practice in different parts of the country. How are these being incorporated into the plans for the bill and for the implementation afterwards? And earlier we were talking about the gap between in implementation. How does current work on the bill ensure that this will not happen with this piece of reform as well?
Okay. In terms of picking the best that's out there, you know, I have made no bones about it. I've said it to this committee previously in terms of other appearances. It is absolutely vital that we pluck the best work and export it right across the board. You know, informing the national high quality standards, we must look for the best. Of the best. That is the aspiration in all of this. However, again, you know, as we continue in this journey, we'll not wait for NCS for some of this. We are already trying to ensure that we are exporting best practice across the board. At the moment, of course, we don't have the power in terms of the national high quality standards to make sure that that becomes a given across the board. And in terms of the implementation gaps and plugging them, you know, why should we have more confidence on this occasion rather than another part of our integration journey? I'm confident because we're actually going to be listening to the voices of lived experience. They know where these gaps are. They know where the difficulties lie. They know the barriers that have been put up from stopping them from getting the care and support that they need. So they are going to be the key in terms of plugging those implementation gaps. And of course, in the future, once this is up and running, if we find that there are gaps or we find that there is practice, you know, that is not working right for people, then we have the ability to change the standards in order to ensure that that is fixed.
Thanks, Convener.
Sandesh.
Thank you. Minister, a lot of witnesses have raised their concerns about co-design processes. You've been hearing Colin Pullman of the RCN said, I think I have been quite clear in saying that the problem is that we do not know. It is absolutely not clear how the co-design process will work, and that has led to anxiety in the workforce. How can you guarantee all relevant parties will be adequately consulted?
Well, we continue to speak to and to listen to, more importantly, everyone. Now, I've given out this morning to Ms Harper an outline of how the collaborative design will work, and I realised that that was a fairly lengthy contribution, so I won't repeat it. But we will send all of that to the committee in letter form so that you know exactly what was said this morning. We'll also outline to you the work, the ongoing work, that there is with my officials, with myself and others around about all that we are doing here. I'm more than happy to outline to the committee who we have been speaking to, who we have been listening to, the meetings that we have had, who has applied to come on to the stakeholder groups. You know, all of this I'm willing to share and be open and transparent about. And I will set all of that out in writing if that's what the committee
really
wishes.
Really helpful, because obviously you can't outline a whole list just now, but it would be really good information for us to have. Sandesh, do you have a follow-up question? And I must move on to Tess.
I do, yes. So in the letter that you write to us, will you also set out exactly how the co-design process will work, including but not limited to how the voices you hear are weighted? How do you resolve conflicting views? Who and where will the decisions be made, and what transparency there will be on those decisions that you make?
What I will do in terms of the letter to the committee is, for transparency, write to you, giving you full detail of all that I've outlined already. But also, I will outline how we're running public workshops on co-design, which all is available on the Scottish Government website. There are two registers promoting this heavily, as I've outlined already, and all registrants will have detailed training around about co-design itself. Now, I'm more than willing to be as open and transparent here as possible. And, you know, co-design, I know, is new for many folk. Some folks see this as being very brave. I see this as being necessary in terms of us getting it right. We will outline all that we're doing here to the committee and later.
If that, we'll put it up on the website. Sandesh, can you really be quick? We're getting at 90 minutes and we're not even halfway through all our questioning. So, quick question and I'll come to test.
Just back on that. So my question was really focused upon what happens once that information has been received. So my question was all about, you know, once you've got that information, what will happen with that, what happens after the public consultation process? And it's that I'm asking you to set out.
After the co-design?
Yes.
We'll set all of that out in the letter to convener. Obviously, as part of the co-design, we're going to have a discussion around about the end product too. So we'll outline all of this in the communication to the committee.
Okay, thank you. Do you have a quick follow-up question before I move on?
Thank you, convener. Minister, welcome the fact that you say you're being open, transparent. The Adult Social Care Independent Review that was published yesterday does not mention your desire to improve maternity benefits for social care staff. If it's so important to you, why is it not mentioned and has it been costed? Is it on top of the £1.3 billion estimate for the NCS? Thank you.
Convener, £1.4 billion, as Ms. White has mentioned, you know, that covers the bill. This is not in the bill. This is action that we are taking now. That statement of intent covers a huge amount of things, including pay and conditions, maternity pay being a condition. Now, not all of these things are spelled out individually in that statement of intent. I picked one off the top of my head, which is one which is extremely important to me. The cost of that, again, off of the top of my head, and I will correct myself if I'm wrong in writing, is around about £4 million, if I remember rightly.
Remind Tess, we've got the Cabinet Secretary coming in to do budget scrutiny and a couple of sessions in the new year, so maybe that's something you might want to pick up. Right, I'm just looking at the clock. The Minister's been sat there for nearly 90 minutes, so we are going to have a break in about 10 minutes' time. But I want to get another theme under our belt before we do that, because we've still got an awful lot to discuss. So questions from Steph and then from Carolyn Mockin before we take a break.
Thank you, Convener. I've got three questions. The first of them, you've touched already on monitoring, evaluation and outcomes. And the bones of it seems to be that we're really good at asking people, what would you like to see? We're maybe not so good at asking people, how was it for you? And that is what really, really matters to people. It's been suggested, for example, that we could adapt the Northern Ireland, England and Wales National Audit and National Survey of Bereaved Carers. But I'm wondering if I can ask you to be quite precise about how success will be measured and evaluated, and perhaps define consistency and quality.
That's a big question. I don't know about...
I've got another two, so just not too long.
Okay. I think we have a long way to go on data. I will have a look at the English, Northern Irish and Welsh situations. But, you know, there is some data that I would like to get my hands on, which is not so easy to obtain. And we have got to do better on that front. And we also need to do better in terms of individuals' data as well. And that's why the National Health and Care Record is important moving forward. And depending on the data sharing agreements from that, we can get much, much more accurate data around about what is going on. And I really do get your point around about consistency and quality of data. Because you will know, you'll have seen it at this committee, some of the data that we receive is often caveated, and quite heavily caveated to boot. So it doesn't necessarily give us the true picture. And, you know, Mr. O'Kane talked earlier about comparing apples with oranges. I often feel that that is what we're doing when we're looking at some comparative data. So absolutely, we need to get better at this. I think the National Health and Care record will go a long way in helping us in that front. And, you know, again, what I would say is that even before NCS, we must continue to refine what data we're collecting, how we're collecting it, and the impacts of that on people.
Thank you, and I appreciate you committing to take a look at that as well there. I'm also interested too in your vision for community health services. Can you provide some clarity? Certainly we've heard in evidence people have concerns around this because it's really, really central. So can you provide some clarity on where that will sit? People have felt that it's missing from the bill, and clearly that's vital if social care is to be viewed as an investment rather than a cost.
Convener, community health is one of the foundations of the National Care Service that we need to get right. And we have learned through early engagement with stakeholders that it is imperative. We continue to engage people with experience here. Community health as it currently stands, that is those services based in the community that provide the first point of contact, diagnosis and treatment, comprises over 90% of all interactions in health. And of course, many problems are identified, managed, or are managed or resolved within the community, making it one of the largest areas of healthcare and one of the most crucial. So that community health, community social work and social care services are the front line. They are, you know, accessed in a variety of ways through many of our health and care sites or even in people's homes or remotely supported by technology. And again, we need to look at the best practice here as we move forward in terms of getting it right for NCS. I should say, for clarity, that health staff, community health staff, will remain within the NHS. Commissioning and planning of community health will be the responsibility of the National Care Service, and that will build on the current integration arrangements that are in place under integrated joint boards.
That real concern seems to be about the fact that, you know, there isn't really any mention of it in the bill. Is that something that maybe needs some further consideration, or where exactly are you at with that?
I don't think it needs to necessarily be mentioned in the bill, but what we all have to be cognisant of is making sure that in the co-design that we get all of this absolutely right and that we get integration absolutely right. You know, one of the things, convener, which has been strange for me, you know, there has been many folk who have said that various things shouldn't be in the bill. So criminal justice shouldn't be in the bill, according to some. Children's services shouldn't be in NCS, according to some. And, you know, there are numerous arguments around about that. And I should say that in those two areas, the government have not taken any decisions yet about whether they should be in or out of National Care Service. But at the Local Government and Housing Committee the other week, there was a suggestion from a member that housing and homelessness services should be in the bill and should be in the NCS. And of course, that's not going to be the case. However, you know, we have to make that the linkages between the National Care Service, no matter what's in or what's out, has the linkages with other services across the board, including housing and homelessness. So there are areas that, you know, that maybe are not being discussed or are not seen to be being discussed by you folks as much as should be, but these are conversations that are being had right across the board.
Thank you. Thank you. My question is
quite specific. It was raised by Alison Kerr, Royal College of Occupational Therapists, again by Francia Kelly, Blackwoods Homes, and then in a session by Henry Simmons from Alzheimer's Scotland. And it's round about rehabilitation and the rights of people to see part of the National Care Service as rehabilitation. And those experienced people indicated that they thought it should be on the face of the bill. And I wondered if the Minister would commit to looking at that.
You know, I will consider anything, but again, I would come back to the point, if we put too much into primary legislation here, we may end up in a situation where it's difficult to change what is there. And I think in terms of rehabilitation, and I don't really like the term reablement, so I'm glad that you have used rehabilitation, Ms. Mohan. I think that, you know, we are seeing advances as we move forward. Now, we don't want to set everything in stone. So secondary legislation is probably the right place for this as well. Obviously, I want these folks, these very good folks, some of whom I know very well, including Fanchia Kelly from my previous role in housing as well, I want them to be at the table helping us shape what is required as we move forward. You know, Blackwood itself, Blackwood Homes, have made some immense advances in terms of the technology that they have put in play in order that folk can live free and independent lives, including a washing machine that irons, convener, which was something that took my eye. I hadn't got in yet, but it's something I've certainly been considering over the piece. You know, we need these folks at the heart. I will consider what they have to say. I don't think it necessarily has to be in primary legislation on the face of the bill, but their voices have to be heard, and we have to get that right as we move forward.
So, Carol, did you have a follow-up question?
No, that's perfect.
Can I go back
you.
To Stephanie?
What,
who did
what
have
I would
follow-up.
Say, because yeah. Miss Kynaston has just pointed this out to me, and if I don't say this, she'll be giving me into trouble. Again, I would refer the committee to the policy memorandum around about this particular area. And Para 38 has that commitment to improve outcomes through prevention and early intervention. And I think that fits in there. Also it is in part one of the bill.
Stephanie, last question before we take a break.
Thank you. I'm grateful for you allowing me to come back in, convener. Minister, last week we had Mark Hazelwood here from the Scottish Partnership for Palliative Care, and he was talking about the fact that, you know, not everybody is going to recover, and that one in three hospital beds are actually used by someone in their last year of life. So there were two things quite specifically that they've put down there that they would like to see included in the bill. So they're talking about putting down in the bill about health, about irreversible health conditions through illness, old age, people who've got their end of life approaching, and secondly, around interventions, about them preventing or delaying the development of care needs and reducing care needs and support for those with irreversible health conditions. So they kind of felt that, you know, end of life wasn't included in the bill, even though it's something that we're all going to face at some point in time, and it's becoming a larger and larger proportion as the demographics change. So I suppose what I'm really, really interested in is those changes to the principles of the bill to include end of life. Is that something that you can take away and consider, or what's your response to that?
I will look at what Mr. Hazelwood said, and Mr. Hazelwood has engaged with us a fair amount, if I remember rightly. He was at the Charter of Rights and Responsibilities co-design the other week. Again, I would come back to the point of, you know, not everything has to be in that primary legislation. And while that end-of-life care is absolutely vital in getting it right, you know, if we put too much into primary legislation, that does not allow us the flexibilities to change. Now, you know, I rule nothing in or nothing out, but probably the best way of getting this right is doing so in secondary legislation with the flexibility to change in the future as care in this area changes, as it has done to a huge degree in recent years. But in terms of points that Mr. Hazelwood has made elsewhere and that others have made too, you know, we have to do all that we can to try and meet the needs of folks at the end of life. You know, I myself have experienced loved ones, friends who have passed at home and who, you know, have had much better experiences because of that. So, you know, we recognise that there's work to be done there, but it's whether that needs to be in primary or secondary legislation.
So just I know I said this was the last question before we give you a break, Minister, but Faisal, what you're saying is if the bill's too prescriptive, then yes, that people involved in that co-design process possibly won't have the agency that they otherwise would in actually doing what they want the National Care Service to do.
So what I would say, convener, and I revert back to my point about SDS, you know, fantastic piece of legislation, we all thought, you know, but some folk have found loopholes there which have not been challenged. They've not been easy to change. I've tried to change some of this through guidance. But, you know yourself, in terms of vehicles for primary legislation, sometimes they don't come along very often. Mm. Whereby, if you find a flaw, if you find a loophole, or, you know, something changes in terms of the way that we deal with an illness or a condition, we can change secondary legislation quite easily. Or easier. And that doesn't mean to say that we don't have folks scrutinising and being open and transparent around about it, because I would expect, if and when secondary legislation is required to be changed, that we continue to have the voices of lived experience guiding us there too.
OK, thank you. We're going to give everyone a break for 10 minutes and then come back. Thank you. Suspend this meeting. Okay, welcome back. We will continue with our question to the Minister on the National Care Service Bill and on the Charter of Rights, Responsibilities, Complaints and Independent Advocacy. We've got questions from David Torrance. David.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. The committee has heard evidence that there's a wide support for a charter, a complaints process and access to independent living. But, and there's always a but, Minister. Previous briefings have said that the model for a charter is not clear. Minister, will the Charter of Rights and Responsibilities provide a clear understanding of what people can expect from a National Care Service in terms of the rights? Will the reference to rights be explicit and will they be enforced, and if so, how?
A big question, a big set of questions. Convener, I should probably start at the very beginning of this because the National Care Service consultation demonstrated without a doubt strong support for a National Care Service Charter of Rights and Responsibilities so that people know what to expect. And therefore we have commenced the work in developing that Charter of Rights and Responsibilities. The design and the development of the Charter will set out the rights and responsibilities of people accessing National Care Service support. It will set out information on the National Care Service complaints and redress system, which will provide recourse if the charter rights are breached. And it will also set out information about how to access further information, advice and advocacy services. And the charter will support people accessing NCS services to better hold the system to account and to receive the services that they need to thrive rather than just survive. Now, you know, one of the things which has been at the fore in terms of discussions that I've had with folks with lived experience is the many people who have had poor service delivery, who have not been cared for in the right way, and then who have found it very, very difficult to get all of that sorted. Often, you know, I hear the same tale, and I've said that if I did a pound for every time I'd heard this, I could probably go on a round-the-world cruise, but not something I'd really want to do in a pandemic period, I have to say. But, you know, folks saying, you know, I complained about this and was told by the Health and Social Care Partnership, that's not us, that's the local authority, or that's the health board, and, you know, it goes on and on and on. That's just not good enough. We have also come across on numerous occasions in terms of the work that we have done, situations where there had been arguments between Health and Social Care Partnership, Local Authority, Health Board, about who's paying for something, and then the person not getting it for a very long time, which actually leads to some real difficulties. So we have got to get this right in terms of the rights and responsibilities. I want people to be empowered, and as I hinted earlier on, you know, I was at, one of the first co-design sessions around about the Charter of Rights and Responsibilities to hear what folk have to say, and there are, you know, some polarised views there that we're going to have to work our way through, but we have to get this right for people.
Thank you, Minister. And around the co-design, we've heard that the co-design is limited to the development of charter and complaints process and independent advocacy. Is this correct, or can you expand on how you've engaged?
Sorry, could you repeat that question?
We have actually heard that co-design is limited to the development of the charter and the complaints process and independent advocacy.
That's not the case. I don't know what has been said there. So if I could get any quotes in that, we will have a look at that and respond accordingly.
Thank you, Minister. And the other one is, what's the timescale for development of the Charter and the independent advocacy complaints process? And will the complaints process be independent of ministers as well as commissioners and care services providers?
Again, in terms of the last point in the question around about independence of this one, that one and the other, we have to work some of these ways, these things through. And that has to be part of the co-design process itself. And we have to look at the accountability aspects around about this too. Again, you know, some of that will be worked through in terms of the co-design. What we do hope, convener, is that we have a skeleton, a draft of all of this by next summer, which is quite ambitious. But I'm sure that with the cooperation of the folks who are helping us develop this, it is achievable.
Thank you. No further questions.
Okay, thank you. I think I'm just looking at our papers in regard to the question that the Minister, and I guess we were asking that is the co-design limited to development of the Charter, the complaints process and independent advocacy, or is the co-design going to do more aspects of the bill? Is the co-design going to be expanded beyond those three things?
Well, I outlined earlier on, convener, some of the main aspects of the co-design in terms of those areas that we need to look at in terms of co-design. And I'll repeat some of them again. I won't go into all of the detail as I did earlier. And we said that
go through some of the co-design themes.
Number two on my list was realising rights and recognising responsibility, which includes the Charter development. The other things were information sharing, which we've touched upon already again this morning, to improve health and social care support, keeping health and social care support local, making sure that voices are heard, and valuing the workforce. But as I said, we will write to you on all of these things.
Okay, I just wanted to give you clarity of what David was potentially getting there. Sorry, David.
Sorry, I didn't quite get that.
But I was just looking at the papers and where you were coming from, just so that's now on the record. So we now want to talk about care boards. And I will hand over to Paul O'Kane.
Very grateful, convener. I wonder if I can begin by asking more broadly about structures. I hear what the Minister says about the need for national standards, and I think there's a large degree of consensus around that. But I think whatever way we look at it, the National Care Service involves structural change, big structural change. So does the Minister feel that there's a risk that structural change becomes an end in itself rather than a means to a greater end?
Structural change is important, but this is not the be-all and end-all of what we're aiming to achieve here. What we have to do is to make sure that we have a service that works for people. There are quite a few arguments out there around about structural change, but the focus of all that we do here has to be on people themselves. The committee will have heard some of the comments that I've made to the many other committees that have appeared in front of around about the purpose of care boards. And I'll go over some of that again, some of which I spoke about earlier, I think, to Emma Harper. So the care service, National Care Service, will balance the need for local flexibility by having the care boards plan and commission care whilst providing national consistency through ministers being ultimately accountable. While local boards will have their own budgets and staff, they will be directly accountable to Scottish ministers. And this will ensure that the standards that we have talked about are maintained across the country so that high quality services are in place, which are reflective of local circumstances as they are delivered. Now, I've had lots of questions, and I'm quite sure Mr. O'Kane might follow up with some of these around about the amount of care boards, the care board compositions, and all of the rest of it. So I'll go through some of that. just now as well. Care board membership will be examined in detail as part of the co-design process, as will the number of care boards. Based on responses from the consultation, we are obviously looking at how membership will include people with lived experience, which is the one point I am adamant about, as I said earlier, so that we're making sure that lived experience is at the very heart of decision making. Now, for some folk, that's been controversial. You know, some people have suggested to me that folks with lived experience in care boards will have vested interests, so shouldn't be there. But, you know, the same argument is also often used for local authority members and various things, and we declare interests and sometimes leave if we do have an interest, so I don't see that as a problem. We'll also consider through the co-design how we might include carers, other professionals, service providers, and local authority elected members and local care boards. And we are committed to ensuring all that in care boards will have full voting rights. The other aspect might be the numbers, as I say, that the numbers of care boards, that's another matter for co-design. However, let's be honest here, I've heard a suggestion from one person that there should be 250 local care boards. I don't think that that is possible, and we have to be honest around about some of the parameters that are there in terms of the co-design.
Thank you. Convener, I wonder if I can just go back in terms of understanding the point about ministerial control and the desire for ministerial control as opposed to that local control. So the Minister had said that people have told him that they want to see ministerial control and accountability, and I appreciate in previous answers he said that he's going to undertake to communicate to committee where that evidence came from, because as he...
73% of folk in the consultation said that they wanted control, Scottish ministers to have control and accountability over this.
OK, but as he knows, people have raised issues around that consultation and how consulted they felt, and we can go through the detail of that. I'm happy to do that, because I speak to lots of people with lived experience as well, and some people have, of course, raised concerns. But I suppose I want to get to the heart of what interest will local authorities have in terms of the delivery of social care if they're not accountable for it? And if they don't hold a statutory responsibility, then what is the role of local authorities?
Well, Mr. O'Kane has been an elected member in a local authority like I have. And councils, local authorities don't just carry out functions that they are statutorily obliged to do. They do other things which are for the good of the people of the area that they represent. Now, as I have said earlier on, we want to ensure that local authorities remain as prime partners for the delivery of high-quality social care in their communities. That is for the good of the people that they represent. And whether they are accountable by law for that or not, I'm sure that the altruists who serve on local authorities will see the huge advantage of ensuring that their people are cared for properly and appropriately and to the highest quality standard. And beyond that, as I pointed out, in terms of local care boards, as with IJBs at this current moment in time, local authority members will play a part.
But would the Minister not recognise that there is a principle here about decisions being taken as close to people as possible and the role of local government in doing that? And he's right to say that him and I have both served, as have other colleagues in committee, on local authorities as councillors. And I'm just keen to understand, why does he feel that it will be more accountable by virtue of 129 MSPs and the Minister having that control as opposed to local councillors? I mean, does he feel that local councillors aren't accountable enough just now and don't represent their constituents in these issues?
I'm going to refer back to the policy memorandum again, because at the end of the day, the National Care Service will be there to provide leadership, oversight and accountability for community health and social care, including by providing strategic direction and planning at a national level and regional level, and performance management and the monitoring of care boards to ensure national standards and expectations are achieved, albeit in a way that suits local circumstances. Now, I have pointed out again and again this morning that local accountability needs to be strengthened too. That is a purpose of this bill. That is what we have heard from people. But that does not stop. None of this stops local decision making. None of this stops local flexibility and innovation. And none of this stops flexibilities around about delivery of services in particular areas. But those national high quality standards must be met. That ends the postcode lottery of care, which again folk want to see. But it doesn't stop flexibility.
Sanders, you have questions on this?
You OK, Minister? So, Minister, you've stated to various committees over the past weeks and to us as well that local authority function staff may not be transferred to care boards at all, and that care boards merely act as a provider of last resort to ensure the continuity and quality of service. So, in what circumstances would you deem that transfer to be necessary?
Well, if there was service failure. So let me give you an example in terms of provider of last resort scenarios at this moment. It may well be that a care home in a particular place collapses. The company may go out of business. The local authority would move in some circumstances as the provider of last resort and take that over and ensure that there is continuity of care for people. These things happen on a fairly regular basis, unfortunately, not just in terms of care homes, but also in terms of some care at home and provision and other things. These things are currently happen.
And there is a feeling that the centralising agenda of the National Care Service will negatively affect rural and island communities disproportionately. Nick Morris of the NHS Chairs Group in Scotland said the logical conclusion is that is suggested by the NTS proposals at the moment is that the island communities would have less control of NHS elements of care because it would all go to a care board. Do you agree with Mr. Morris's interpretation, and how are you going to mitigate powers being taken away from these local providers?
I don't see this as centralisation at all. And I should say to the committee, and some of the folk around the table will be aware, I was the first minister to island proof a bill, the fuel poverty bill, before the islands bill has passed. And in all of the work that we're doing here, we take cognizance of the different erts and perts of our country and how we need to get it right for everyone. So we have a separate work stream at this moment looking at islands and what we can do there, and looking at some of the suggestions that have been made by some authorities about how they can maybe deliver in all of this differently. I've been in Shetland over the piece a few months back to listen to their views. I'm due to go to Orkney at the beginning of the year. And there have been suggestions from some island leaders, not all, I would hasten to add, and that needs to go on the record, not all, but there have been suggestions around about single island authorities. Now, that's something that the government will look at. In terms of are more rural areas, particularly remote rural. As I said earlier, there is an opportunity here with ethical procurement to change the way that we do things. And I hope that those opportunities will be grasped. We have to look at how we deliver across the board. I will do that. My officials know what needs to be done in that regard. And again, we have gone out of our way to find voices of lived experience from our more remote rural and island areas whose difficulties are often much different from those folks in my own community in Aberdeen in order that we get it right for everyone.
Thank you, Convener. So we know that integration joint boards are not always delivering and that voices are sometimes not heard on the integration joint boards. And, you know, clearly there are some concerns from some people that really we're just recreating a system that kind of moves people around when we talk about care boards. Sets them in a different seat, if you like. So I'm wondering, are you able to give us an example of any area that's kind of working like a care board just now? And I'm thinking myself of Granite Care Consortium, where they've got health and social care partnership, they've got lived experience, they've got providers who've got a different range of expertise, where they're actually all very much sitting around one table and collaborating together and everybody has a voice. So really interested if that's the kind of vision that you have in mind for it. And secondly, we've heard a few times from different people about the suggestion of having a national care board that's a kind of overarching, if you like, the local care boards. So just your views or comments on that as well. Thank you.
Convener, I think Ms Callaghan is enticing me to be naughty here, which I'm not going to do. And I'm not going to name where I think necessarily things are good or where things are bad. I think it's very clear that those areas where there is increased delegation to IJBs, to health and social care partnerships, they tend to perform better. Where there are budget flexibilities, those areas tend to perform better. But I think there are other aspects of this as well in terms of the scrutiny agenda. And I don't know how many of you around the table are as anorakish as I am. But, you know, I've gone out of my way at points to dig a little bit deeper as always, which I'm prone to doing. And you look at some IJB agendas and minutes, and you can see quite clearly that they are taking their scrutiny responsibilities very seriously indeed, and they are making some really key decisions. And the frustrating side of the coin is, you know, that some IJBs, you look at the agenda and the items in the agenda, often which are pretty serious items, are for noting only. And it doesn't look like that there's a level of scrutiny or decision-making that there should be. Now, you know, don't take my word for that. Go and have a look at them yourself. What we actually need to get to is a position where local care boards are scrutinising and taking the decisions and being accountable to the populace at large for the decisions that they are taking. In terms of the suggestion of a national care board, I've heard that suggestion from some. I'm not entirely convinced. It may just be another bureaucratic layer, and I'm not really one for bureaucracy, as you well know. But my ears are still open on that one.
Thank you.
Emma.
Convener. Just a couple of questions on the establishment of care boards There is a number of sections in the bill that talks about establishment and abolition of care boards, directions of care boards, removal of care boards, and just I'm interested to hear, I suppose, how do we move forward in developing the care boards and who'll be on the care boards, and then will they be commissioning bodies or delivery bodies or a bit of both?
Right. That's a huge question, which may take a very long time to answer. So let me be as brief as I can, and then I'll fill in some of the other detail in writing to the committee. Obviously, in terms of the care boards themselves and some of that design work around about who's around that table, all the rest, I've already said this morning that that's part of the co-design process. It has been thrown at me that the bill itself means that I could appoint and discard care board members at my will, or my successor could do that. You know, that's not the case. And, you know, many of the powers that we're talking about here are powers that are there in terms of NHS boards too, and, you know, powers are used extremely sparingly indeed. But this is an area where I maybe probably need to tease out even more detail for the committee. So if you're agreeable, convener, that's maybe an area that I'll follow up in writing.
Thank you. Emma, did you
and I'll give some of the comparisons that I've made with other bodies, if that suits you.
Yeah, just a final question. In evidence, Karen Hedge from Scottish Care had concerns that care boards might just be recreating a system that exists already. I know we've heard folk talk about moving the deck chairs around as well. So I am just seeking clarity that this is about establishing a care system that will benefit the people on the ground who have been asking for better care and support for them personally.
Absolutely. This is not about moving the deck chairs at all. You know, I'm not into that kind of game. What we need to do is take cognizance of the views that we have heard from those who are in receipt of care and support, their carers and frontline staff, around about the improvements that are required. Also, I would come back to the point that I made in my opening statement. We cannot just tinker at the edges here. We have a changing demography here in Scotland, and we need to expand the social care workforce, as I said earlier, too. So we cannot just tinker at the edges. We need to make real change. And, of course, in so doing, people have to be at the very heart of all of that.
Okay, thank you.
A number of members who want to ask questions around commissioning and procurement. I'll start off with Carol Mochan. Carol.
Great, thank you very much. I'm particularly interested to go back again to Fair Work. And I want to ask the Minister, we have heard quite clearly from the evidence of people coming to the committee that there is so much that can be done now. And I want to ask the Minister if he can make a commitment to look at what has been achieved so far and push forward with that without having to have it rely on the bill.
I've already given an assurance this morning that we are moving on many of these fronts. That's why, you know, we have the statement of intent with COSLA. There are things which I want to have seen done yesterday myself, and we will continue to try and advance in all of these. What I would say to Ms. Mochan and others in the committee, sometimes these things are not quite so easy, and what I would like to see is national sectoral bargaining as envisioned in terms of our NCS proposals.
Just briefly to the Minister on that. Can you tell me what the key barrier is to that? Because all the evidence that we heard from the trade unions, professional organisations and some of the third sector is that this should be happening. So I'm unclear what the key barrier that you find in government is to this.
Key barriers are 1,200 disparate employers, as I said earlier, who are working to contracts which government has no control over. You know, again, what I would say is, you know, those two wage rises, you know, which I wanted, everybody here wanted into folks' pockets and purses as quickly as possible, is not the easiest thing to achieve. Again, you know, we do our level best here, but there are things which we are reliant on others in doing at this moment in time, which often makes things not as easy as it may seem.
Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. It's been suggested that reinforced provisions on commissioning and procurement would be an important way of giving practical effect to embedding Fair Work principles in the social care sector. I appreciate there are complexities to this and that the Minister has said that work is ongoing on this. What provisions would the Minister like to see within the bill, and would he work with myself and others on amendments ahead of stage two to embed some of these?
Convener, as always, I'm more than happy to work with anyone in terms of ensuring that we get things right as we move forward. That's not to say that I'll support every amendment, let's be honest. But if we can work in partnership together to get the most out of all of this, then I'm more than happy to do so. I think that Ms. Mackay knows that ethical procurement is one of the top things in my agenda. I want to make sure that we do our level best to get all of this right and to embed Fair Work principles as much as we possibly can. However, I should highlight to the committee, as you're all very well aware, is that employment law is not a power that this Parliament holds. So we have to do that, as always, with great care. But it has been achieved previously in other bills, forestry, if I remember rightly, and I think that we need to do so again. And if that means cooperation and collaboration with other members to get this right, more than happy to do so.
If that's okay. The policy memorandum describes a new national social work agency that will be a department of government. Some witnesses have requested that this agency be independent. What's your view on this, and what would you say to those who believe that the agency should be independent of government?
The Independent Review of Adult Social Care recommended the establishment of a national organisation for training, development, recruitment and retention for adult social care support, including that specific social work agency for the oversight of professional development. And the policy memorandum again outlines the intention to establish that agency. And, you know, there are a number of things which folk have come to me with around about the social work aspect of this. And we're going to continue to listen to what folk are suggesting. I think that, you know, from our perspective, it should be part of the National Care Service, but we have listened as we've gone along, and, you know, we will flex if need be on that front. If somebody can convince me the advantages of that being entirely separate, you know, I'll listen. However, we've got to remember that there are huge linkages between community health, social work and social care. And what we don't want is to create a further fragmentation, if you like, in all of this. As the committee can well imagine, I have had a fair amount of meetings over the piece with various social work bodies. I should apologise, I had to miss one last week because I was unwell, but we'll continue to do that as we move forward and to listen to their voices. You know, I have to be cognizant of the linkages, and if there is something different, Does that cause fragmentation? And what does that do to service delivery for people, which is the number one thing?
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Concerns have been raised that without a cultural shift, reform would replicate the same problems in a new setting, and some highlighted the need for retraining to ensure consistency. How can the government ensure that there is going to be a cultural shift, and how can these issues be dealt with?
I think that that is the big question, because, you know, we can talk about legislative change, regulatory change, we can talk about planning changes too. And often that has not led to real change. But what we have discussed this morning around about what is happening in certain parts of Scotland, if we could replicate elsewhere through ethical procurement, through fair work, we're going to get that cultural change. At the end of the day, if we look at that Aberdeen situation again, I know we keep picking on that, I know the committee's been there, I've been there, so it's one that we all know. Giving staff that freedom, that flexibility, that independence in the front line changes cultures dramatically. It's not just in terms of social care, it's also in terms of social work. I'm due to visit Fife shortly, where they, in a couple of areas, they've given social workers a clean sheet, basically, around about what they can do. Already it seems there are some very positive outcomes from that. That freedom for social workers was embedded in the 1968 Act. That's moved away from that. And, you know, many of the social workers I've talked to feel that they are not empowered to take the right decisions at the right time for people because they feel that eligibility criteria and budgets get in the way. We have to move away from that. And again, that means a massive culture shift, which can be achieved. So that legislation, regulation is fine. But in order to get that culture shift, it is about empowering the front line again. And we can do that in terms of ethical procurement and fair work. We need to be trusting of a workforce that should be trusted.
Thank you. Evelyn, can I move on to another colleague, or have you got any follow-up? Okay. Tess.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, the Convener for the Finance and Public Administration Committee, Kenneth Gibson, said that the bill it seems that the government is using a sledgehammer to crack a nut, with your own party and the Finance Committee raising concerns about the spending of this bill. How can you possibly justify the costs? I thought it was 1.3 billion. You actually said this morning it was 1.4 billion, and that's not including terms and conditions of employment and benefits. And some even say it's an open checkbook.
Convener, I don't think that Ms. White has necessarily been listening to some aspects of I've said this morning about the financial memorandum and the fact that it covers a fair amount of costs in terms of staffing and terms and conditions. What I would say is that we need to change. Folk recognise that change is required. We cannot continue with the same system. Derek Feely highlighted that in the Independent Review in Adult Social Care. We need to plan and invest for the future, in order that those of us, and that is probably the bulk of us, that will require care and support in the future, have the right care and support in the future. And, you know, as for the analogy of a sledgehammer to crack a nut, there are many folks out there with lived experience that would have used sledgehammers long before now, it has to be said. And I would be very naughty if I was to repeat what someone from the Social Covenant Steering Group said. But, you know, for many of the folk, the sledgehammer has not come out quickly enough.
Thank you. Minister, social workers have been described as the GPs of social care. David Grimm contacted me about a letter sent to you in October by Lauren McNamara from Student Awards Agency Scotland, signed by 316 social work students and 20 lecturers. And they're asking for a student social work bursary. And is this something that you are actively considering as part of your joint statement with COSLA, or is it something the National Care Service might be able to provide?
I can't remember seeing the letter from Laura McNamara, but we will have a look at that and respond accordingly.
Thank you. Right, we will now move on to talk about continuity of the transition community health, and I have a number of members. Members, can I ask you, if you do have a follow-up question, can it be brief, because we're getting to the point where we're going to start eating into other business if we take too much time. So questions led by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. On the homelessness side of things, Minister, how do you envision the bill will engage with those experiencing homelessness, particularly through community health, and how do we envisage the bill improving the lives of those who are experiencing homelessness and other things that may bring chaotic periods in people's lives?
Convener, this subject is very close to my heart because of my previous job. And just because you change jobs, you don't forget about things. The greatest breakthroughs that we have made in recent times in terms of tackling rough sleeping and those folks who are the most vulnerable has been the work that we have done in terms of Housing First, which brings housing, care, health and others together in order to create the right environment for somebody to thrive in their own home. And, you know, that has been immensely successful, more successful than any of us maybe could have hoped to imagine, with the last figures I've seen, and they may be out of date, with 90% tenancy sustainment. And we need to ensure that services, no matter who or what they are wrapped around the individual in order to get that right for people. And some of our changes in homelessness legislation obviously will put duties on folk to do that. The National Care Service has a big role to play in all of this. And I talked earlier on around about the linkages that we need to create to ensure that we get this right. And that's why, I've met with and will continue to meet with folks from the housing and homelessness sector. And it's also why Shona Robison and I have met on a fairly regular basis with officials in order that we get this absolutely right as we move forward.
Maybe many people who transition through different tenures of housing during their social care journey, whether they be disabled people or whether they be people who are maybe approaching the end of life and who may move from, for example, a family home into either supported accommodation, sheltered housing, for example, or into palliative care or a care home. How can we ensure through the National Care Service and through co-design that we take on board some of the experience, good or bad, that people have had through those journeys, and that we make those journeys and those transitions as smooth as possible for people?
I think Ms. Mackay's taken me back to my old job here as well. It is often immensely frustrating when housing itself is causing a difficulty for somebody to live a fulfilled and independent life. And there has been a substantial amount of investment over the last number of years in trying to get this right. You know, if you look at where we're at in Scotland, particularly with our social sector, but also in terms of some of the mid-market builds, housing for varying need has been at the heart of that build. And again, my figures are out of date, so I probably won't quote them. But, you know, the vast bulk of the social housing that we have delivered was to the housing for varying need standard, so that if folks' circumstances changed, they could still live in their in the same home. However, we recognise that housing for varying need standard was a bit old, and a review has been undertaken. Not exactly sure where we are in that review, but, you know, I'll get back to the committee after liaison with Ms Robeson around about that. But it's important that we recognise that there are changing circumstances in terms of people and people living longer and various circumstances. So that design guide for varying need had to change. And also, you know, they're looking at changes to building standards as well to underpin a Scottish accessible home standards, which all new homes must achieve. Also, again, convener, there has been a lot of discussion around about aids and adaptations, because, you know, sometimes a wee thing, a wee change in a house can make it livable. And if it's not there, it means that somebody is unable to stay at home. So again, a lot of work and discussion between areas of government around about aids and adaptations.
Great. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, convener. just to pick up on where you were at there already, and I have to say, Housing First was a revelation. It really, you could see it really changing people's lives on the ground there. And it was all about that wraparound care, that seamless joined up services there. And I suppose really almost like a public health approach at population level is the kind of bigger picture of that there. So clearly, you know, we've got housing and homelessness, but we've also got all those other local services that are really closely related to social care, mental health, drugs, alcohol issues, etc. So can I ask you, why is the NCS the way forward to really get this seamless joined up care that people are looking for that really matters to them?
Let's take the example that Ms Callaghan gave around about drugs and mental health. Angela Constance and I at points seem like we're joined at the hip in terms of getting it right for folks who have more than one difficulty. And I have to be honest and say that services in many parts of the country are not what they should be when it comes to the like of dual diagnosis. And that's why, you know, we are already changing standards, have got a number of pilots on the go around about getting this right. Now, these things should become the norm. That's why we need national high quality standards in order to get it right for everyone. And we cannot have a situation where we're pushing folk from pillar to post. So these are that's one of many reasons why, you know, we need to have that completely joined up approach. And what I would say is, in terms of folks through Housing First, you know, where there has been substance use and mental health difficulties, we have managed to overcome those barriers for those folks in Housing First in many, many of the occasions. We should and need to be doing that right across the board for everyone who may have those kind of situations in their lives.
Just ask you as well then, one of the kind of barriers to that seems to be, like, you know, this idea of incorporating community health, primary care services, etc., too, and that kind of public health approach there. Can that really be achieved, you know, if we're saying that no health staff can be transferred into the National Care Service?
Yes, it can be achieved. And, you know, we are seeing changes now in certain areas in terms of how we're dealing with folk. So, yes, it can.
Thank you.
I wonder if I can ask the Minister what will happen to health and social care partnerships as we understand them, given the process of integration that's happened in various local authorities.
What do you mean, what's happened to them?
What will happen to them? So, you know, what will the status, if you like, be of health and social care partnerships within this? Do we envisage them not existing in their current form and being redeveloped through the National Care Service process?
As I've said, we intend to establish local care boards, and the co-design around about local care boards and delivery will be worked on with the voices of lived experience, with frontline staff, with stakeholders, in order to get this right. I think that there's a huge amount of learning to be garnered from what has happened in health and social care partnerships. Mr. O'Kane represented East Renfrewshire, a health and social care partnership which has achieved a great deal. Again, I came back to my point earlier around about those areas where more services have been devolved seems to work better. Now, I want to ensure that the learning and the good practice from health and social care partnerships like East Renfrewshire are captured in terms of the delivery of our future services. I also want to, of course, look at those places where that has not worked quite so well and learn the lessons from that too.
Thank you, Convener. The Minister will hear no complaints from me in terms of singing the praises of East Renfrewshire, and I think he makes a fair point in terms of the length of time that integration has been, you know, part of the fabric of certain communities and trying to learn from that. I wonder if I can just turn briefly to the social work element of that and the further consultation the Minister intends to undertake around children's services and criminal justice social work. I wonder if the Minister can say anything about his intended timescales for that further piece of consultation.
Convener, we were very well aware that in terms of the work that we've done in adult social care, that we had a huge amount of information, a huge amount of consultation had been carried out. We have undertaken to do similar in terms of looking at children's services and criminal justice social work, which, you know, work is ongoing at this moment in terms of looking at all of that. We will continue to consult and listen to people on those fronts. I would reiterate again, the government has taken no decision on transferring children's services or criminal justice social work to the National Care Service at this moment in time.
Did you have a question on this?
It's been answered, thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Right, we move on to talk about Anne's Law, which is the final theme that we're going to cover. Questions from Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Many of those who gave evidence were worried that Anne's Law was ambiguous and did not contain enough assurance that visits would still be permitted in the event of another public health crisis. Can you offer reassurance, Minister?
So the key powers, well, the NCS Bill will allow Scottish ministers to exercise powers under Section 782 of the Public Services Reform Act to require care home service providers to comply with any directions issued by ministers. Now, the key issues that you have talked about that have been raised by stakeholders is that our proposed approach to delivering Anne's Law through the directions doesn't go far enough. that Anne's Law should be extended beyond adult care homes to cover additional settings, and we have talked to others around about this, and there's dubiety about that. They also have talked about the importance placed upon local decision making, and again, and well understandable, the importance of human rights and a person-centred approach as we move forward. So, you know, in the recent parliamentary consultation, some respondents indicated concern about the approach that we are taking, whether that use of directions is the right approach. I think it is absolutely the right approach, that use of directions. The most challenging issue in terms of addressing all of this in terms of the use of the directions has been how to balance the views of some that endorse the occasional need to restrict, and that in the main is Public Health Scotland and others, on health grounds. Although the directions themselves envisage continuous visiting during outbreaks, we expect formal advice from Public Health Scotland that will highlight that this is at risk to outbreak management. So what we have at the moment is a piece of an additional work going on, looking at every single aspect of this. But as a minister, I want to ensure that people have access to their loved ones. Now, we will have to have balance in some of that, but that is my expectation. Now, quite rightly, you know, people are always going to be concerned. They're going to think at the back of their mind around about what went on during that COVID period. We don't want that to happen again. And that's why we are doing all the work that we can here to ensure that we get this right for relatives and families and loved ones.
People welcomed the legislation providing for breaks, but carers said that they felt really, even if they were to get a break, they would find it really difficult to relax. Can you offer reassurance regarding high level of replacement care and something that carers can trust?
Well, this is a key thing. And, you know, having had the Carers Parliament events here and around about here in recent weeks, you know, that situation whereby some folks are worried to leave their loved ones, or, you know, there are cases where folks just cannot leave their loved ones. How do we flex all of this to ensure that we are putting some support in place? Now, you know, we have in this bill the rights to breaks from caring. But, you know, one body argued with me the other week that, you know, that right could be there, but I'm not going to get that break because my loved one needs me all of the time. So what else can we put in place to ensure that we are giving somebody the time and the ability for some downtime, even being there? We have to work our way through this. There's been some really good stuff that has gone on in certain places whereby, you know, folks have been unable to go for short-term breaks. But other things have been put in place, and I'm swear to say this because I could identify people, but other things have been put in place which are beneficial to them and to their loved ones, which, you know, is maybe not as good as a break itself, but allows for some relaxation, for some downtime. I should probably say as well, convener, in all of this, that we're setting up a stakeholder working group, including carers, statutory services and carer centres, to look at the issues that need to be addressed here. And again, you know, we'll continue to listen to what folk have to say, because some of the stories that I've heard even in the past couple of weeks are new to me.
I wonder if I could pick up on your answer to Evelyn around Anne's Law. Last week we had a number of people in front of us who said that this lack of access to their loved ones was still happening. I mean, it could be COVID-related, it might be sort of like infection control measures, which are understandable, but there are maybe just, they go too far and that people don't have access to it. I mean, what can be done now to making sure that doesn't happen?
So I keep a very close eye on this, convener. I've already used direction powers, as folk are aware. And I get regular updates from the care inspectorate around about any complaints that come in, around about anybody being denied access. Those complaints to the care inspectorate have lessened dramatically. They are very few now. I wouldn't want to give you figures, but we can provide you with that. I also get on, I think it's a fortnightly basis, you know, a list of where there are outbreaks, what is going on there, you know, and it is rare to see a home closed for admission now, and it is, you know, rare to see no visits. But I can provide you with much more detailed information on that. But I can assure the committee that, you know, this is something that I keep a very, very close eye on indeed, and officials from here will challenge if they think there's anything which is not working right for people.
That for the public, for people find themselves in that situation,
absolutely.
It's the care inspector that they should be going to.
Absolutely. The care inspector in the first instance should be their first port of call. Well, their first port of call should be with the care home itself. You know, why is this happening? Why am I being denied this? And then if they don't get the right answer, if they don't get the access, then the care inspectorate. But, you know, those numbers have gone down dramatically. But okay, we'll provide you with that information for your reassurance.
Okay. Final questions you'll all be pleased to hear from Emma. I'm not saying that in the pejorative way to Emma. That's how it came out of my mouth, but I just mean final questions for this session, Emma.
Just a quick question on the carers' breaks. Last week it came up about sufficient breaks, and sufficient breaks would be different for one person versus another. And so I was interested in following up on questions about that. But the bill does talk about defining sufficient breaks. It says that regulations under subsection 2 may in particular make provision about the meaning of any reference to sufficient breaks in this Act. And then standards and criteria in relation to the sufficiency of such breaks, including the nature, frequency or duration of breaks. So just with regard to breaks, because Richard Mead presented at the Health Inequality Cross-Party Group last week, we talked a bit about breaks, and there's a lady called Susan Chambers from PASDA, which is an East Lothian support group for people with autism. So I'd be interested to hear your thoughts about sufficient breaks, and I'm not necessarily sure that there needs to be further information in the bill if it can be dealt with by regulation, but just to comments on sufficient breaks.
We recognise, as you have done there, that caring roles vary in nature and intensity. And we recognise the fact that some folk feel more able to access certain things than others. And, you know, one of the key aspects of this which comes up time and time again is around about eligibility criteria. So the bill aims to shift, in removing some of those eligibility criteria for those unable to access sufficient breaks. The bill aims to shift the balance to enable more carers to access preventative short break support. And those may have to be something different from what maybe currently an offer in particular places. But the key aspect of all of this to understand more around about what sufficient is, to recognise what those differences are in terms of the nature and the intensity of the care. We need to understand that better, and that's the reason why that stakeholder group has been established, convener, to work our way through this, including reaching a definition around about sufficient breaks.
Thank the Minister and all these officials for the time they spend, the extra time that they're given to answer our questions. No members have indicated that they've got any other questions to ask, so I'm going to wind up our session now. So that was our final meeting of 2022. Our first meeting in the new year will be taking evidence on the Scottish Budget for 2023-24 from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. And can I take this opportunity to wish everyone a happy and restful festive period, and again reiterate my thanks for everyone out there in Scottish society that's helped us with our work over the course of this year. But that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you. Thank you.